Jeffrey Epstein did not commit suicide.
I see you're Jeffrey Epstein, and I raise you that there was a second gunman on the grassy knoll.
I see you're grassy knoll, and I raise you Elvis is still alive and living upstairs at Graceland.
Paul McCartney died in the 60s, and they replaced him with a double.
Jet fuel cannot melt steel beams.
The royal family are really reptiles.
Flat Earth?
Oh no, you can't have that one. That's not a conspiracy. I mean, millions of people believe that all around the globe.
How's your pizza, Nick?
That's good.
In a world of conspiracies, what's going on? Join us 2 p.m. for the LIVEcast.
There is a secret cabal ruling the world, and we're here to tell you how to deal with all of that. My name is Glen Scrivener. Welcome to the LIVEcast. And with me, as ever, there is Paul Feesey.
Hello, yes, that is me, Paul Feesey, I would like to say, not Paul Fizzy. Yes. So the YouTube auto captions did me wrong last week. And someone sent me a picture of the LIVEcast last week with myself saying, hello, I'm Paul Fizzy,
yes.
Which then garnered quite a lot of comments.
Well, especially because the freeze frame, you did seem to be eking out some kind of fizz.
Like something was fizzing out of me.
Yes, yes. You seem to be quite fizzy.
Yes.
As you,
Yeah, and so now I'm stuck with that. And actually all Sunday at church, I had people coming up, all from a distance, a social distance.
Yes.
Making references to my fizziness.
Well, yeah. If you want to start a rap career, you could be P Fizzle.
P Fizzle. Yeah.
P to the A to the U to the L. Yeah.
Yeah. And well, someone suggested I should start using the phrase, get busy with the fizzy. That's what we're doing here today, people. It's time to get busy with the fizzy.
Yeah, let's get livey with the scrivey. I don't know.
But I thought actually at the end, when I finished, like when I do my mic drop, I can just look at the camera and say, fizzle out.
It's better to fizzle out than to fade away. I say scrivey getting livey, but we're not live again.
No.
And we do need to apologize for this. We are getting the gear in place so that we can go live, but the thing is, when you get such cool gear, you then need to have other gear that goes with the cool gear that you've got in order for it all to work together. So very soon we'll be going live and we'll be receiving your top chat comments along the way. We really miss those. But we thought we'd do a little bit of a mailbag to begin with before we get onto the secret cabal that is ruling the world and discuss conspiracy theories together. We wanted to talk about the last couple of videos that we've done. And 2 weeks ago, we did a live cast on Christian atheism, drawing on the wisdom of Slavoj Žižek and Douglas Murray and Tom Holland, and attracting all the viewers from YouTube who love getting their stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, I've only just had a quick look, and I hadn't realized it had garnered such a response. I think it's got about 257 comments, which I'd not realized at all.
Yeah. I've been going down into YouTube comments, and
you're a braver man than I.
I know. Usually YouTube comments, well, sometimes YouTube comments can be the scuttling underbelly of the internet. But on this occasion, there were lots of people who are very glad to have found us and subscribed to us for the first time. So if you're new to Speak Life, then hello, and you'll get plenty more material like we just created in terms of Christian atheism, because we're just about to start Reset, where we're interviewing people like Douglas Murray and like Tom Holland, and we're talking to them about how Christianity has built the West and what do we do if we've walked away from Christianity into a meaning crisis. Is there a way back? We think there is a way back, hitting the reset button and going back to the beginning, to our ancient origin stories in Genesis. So we're really looking forward to that. We were hoping to have our Tom Holland interview ready by last Friday. With a few kinks in the hose, we should be able to release it this week and kick off a series where we've got 16 interviews, 7 episodes, and we'll be trying to get the best of biblical scholarship and the best of cultural analysis to figure out this meaning crisis and whether Genesis can still speak today. So that was 2 weeks ago. We looked at Christian atheism, and then last week we looked at Cuties, that very controversial film launched on Netflix very recently, and there's been a bit of feedback on that as well. What are people saying in the mailbag?
Number of people just glad to be having the conversation, good to be hearing some kind of discussion around it that's positive in the sense of drawing something from it rather than just kind of shouting at it. I guess one thing that came up was is who can comment on this,
right?
So there were a few people who felt that the story is a woman's story, a female story, and therefore as two men, we shouldn't really be commenting on it, or we've somehow missed the point. So I mean, I think I'm not sure it came up in the actual live cast. I'm not sure. I think we discussed it, but it may not have come into the actual final cut. But you know, we did talk at one point about us both being parents of girls.
Yeah.
You know, so we've got four girls between the two of us. So and we felt therefore actually that there is a relevance to our discussion as fathers, you know, talking about this thing where actually we're raising daughters in this kind of environment,
where in the story the absence of Amy's father is actually a huge deal, and his terrible behavior, his inability to limit his own sexual desires for the sake of others, leads to a lot of pain for Amy and leads her to waltz off into sexualized, secular social media life that actually, you know, ends up dominating her in terrible ways. And even the director said that actually the sins of the father were quite significant in the telling of the story. And so, you know, I can see how if we're just two guys talking about the experience of an 11-year-old girl, what do we know? That's true. But I think the way we talked about it was to actually address things to men in particular, and to for men to get their acts together. So hopefully we can say that thing to men, and others can say other things to women. And
yeah, I think so. And we are by no means the only people having these conversations. There's plenty of other people out there having conversations. So, I mean, obviously there are other voices on it, and that's absolutely fine. You know, and I think at the end of the day, I mean, I'm quite nervous as well of saying only these people can have an opinion on this or these people can have an opinion on that. To me, that's quite a modern idea that doesn't seem to stack up.
It's not sustainable. I mean,
well, no, and also you drive it down to the point we could have had a woman on, I suppose, who could have spoken here in the flesh. But you know, would she have reflected the life of an 11-year-old Muslim girl in a dance troupe?
Yeah.
In France, you know, it's, where'd you draw the line? You know? And I'm not trying to be facetious with that. I mean, I genuinely think that's the level you can reach where you think, how on earth do you get anyone to talk about these things?
Yeah, and we did play clips from the director and what she wanted to get out of the film. And so we were trying to interact with her view and take her view seriously. And we also, interestingly, in an interview I did a few days earlier than the live cast, I was interviewing Catherine Burble-Singh, and I asked her about QDs, and she gave her opinion about QDs on that program. So this is not in any way, shape, or form attempting to eliminate or, you know, erase the voice of women on these issues.
No.
But we're just saying, because different people can speak from different perspectives, let's have more conversations, not less. And I look forward to hearing different opinions on QDs, and hopefully others can look forward to hearing some dads talk about dad stuff.
Sure.
You know? So that was Christian Atheism and QDs. And if you're not subscribed on YouTube, then you can go to Speak Life Media and subscribe to us in the link below. That would be great. We want to talk about the secret cabal that is ruling your world. Because in the news again, QAnon has hit the headlines here in the UK and in the Observer newspaper over the weekends. There was a story about QAnon, and not only how popular or prevalent it is in the US, but actually there are instances of QAnon having an effect here in the UK. Tell us, what was the Observer article saying?
Sure. Well, so I found one from The Guardian. Don't know if it was...
they are the same people, aren't they?
Are they?
I think on the weekend, The Guardian becomes The Observer.
I did not know that.
Right now, we could be corrected we go.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yes, so QAnon is what's supposedly this far-right conspiracy that says there's this cabal of Satan-worshipping pedophiles running a global child trafficking, sex trafficking ring, and that's plotting against Donald Trump, who's battling them. Which will lead to a day of reckoning involving the mass arrests of journalists and politicians. And that day is sometimes called the storm or the great awakening. So this seems to have started off kind of about 3 years ago, back on the kind of forum 4chan with this anonymous figure called Q, who posted, and they claimed to kind of be someone who had high level security clearance somewhere in the US, and kind of posted quite cryptic messages and things. And they claimed to have this kind of classified information about Trump, the Trump administration and his opponents and stuff like that. And, you know, there seemed to have been over time, I think, 4,000 posts known as Q drops, which have kind of fueled the growth of this kind of narrative. And lots of things are linked to it. So anti-vaccine stuff, anti kind of 5G conspiracies, anti-Semitic, anti kind of immigrant kind of tropes and stuff like that. And kind of saying that the people behind this are the liberal elites, so people in Hollywood and Democratic politicians and other kind of high-ranking officials. And this is all kind of going on behind the scenes, and it's hidden away, and they keep it secret. So I guess stuff like maybe the Epstein's, you know, that kind of stuff, people would link those kind of things and say, look, there's this... this shadowy
pedophilia
thing.
Pedophilia is quite a big...
It's a massive thing, isn't it? Yeah, so, it's a huge thing. So... And it seems to have come out actually of the Pizzagate thing again about this paedophile, a supposed paedophile ring involving senior Democratic officials that was being run out of a pizza restaurant in Washington, and people were linking Hillary Clinton to it and stuff. So you can kind of you can get a sense from that where it's come from. And now apparently it also has some basis in something called the Elders, the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. So, which to my understanding is an anti-Semitic kind of paper or a bit of writing, which has been shown to be a faked kind of forgery thing, which had kind of been used in the early 20th century by people like the Nazis and others as well. Basically saying, you know, the Jews have this, there's this plot for global domination by Jews and stuff. So it's very, you know, there's a lot of that kind of thing in there.
Bits about JFK, is there
I didn't I didn't see any JFK stuff, but I mean presumably the further down the rabbit hole you go, there may well be that kind of stuff in there. There's something, blood libel, that was something they were talking about, so talking about
anti-Semitic stuff
then. And again anti-Semitic stuff, so that people were taking the children draining their blood and mixing it
to make the matzah for
Passover and things like that. So there's all this kind of stuff in there. But the interesting, I mean, and that, as you say that, you kind of go, oh, this all sounds absolutely crazy.
Right.
Who on earth is going to buy this? But interestingly, it seems to be that it's taking some ground, that it's poking its head out into the into the world a little bit more than perhaps you would have assumed.
Even to the point where those who are standing for election this November, some of them have posted positively about QAnon. I mean, I think the president, I think Donald Trump has... like retweeted
something like over 200 tweets of Donald Trump's have either kind
last
of endorsed
I heard was
70 it,
but yeah I can believe
I thought it was something but I mean I think I've got here in 2020 in the 2020 US election, so those coming up in a month or two, there were 14 congressional candidates on the ballot for November who expressed support for the theory. So there's been a couple as well, I think, who've mentioned it and then have backtracked on it as well.
But when you say the theory, like your explanation of it, like points to the fact that it's very eclectic. It's this sort of loose assortment of conspiracy theories.
Yeah, I guess so.
Which gives plausible deniability at one stage, because you could be like, well, I believe that, but not that nonsense.
Absolutely.
And that sort of thing.
And I don't know. I mean, we obviously had earlier in the year here in the UK, we had people destroying phone masts and stuff like that, and I don't know whether that was specifically linked back to this. I mean, it talks about 5G here, but I don't know whether those were an offshoot of this.
I was at Eastbourne Seafront, this is about 2 months ago, and I was with my son and my daughter, and I was waiting for my wife to come, so I got out my phone to see if she'd messaged me, and there was a girl like on a bench over to my right about 20 meters away saying, you know that can harm your children. And I turned over and I said, what? She said, 5G. You know that will harm your children.
Wow.
Like, as if I've got 5G. Like, see my phone? You know. But, yeah. So that was the first time I'd kind of come across somebody who,
I actually got a post taken down off Facebook about 5G.
Really?
Because I posted a picture, which was, it was one of those things about, it was like a taking the mic, you know, where it's like a bat that sends radar, a bat with coronavirus sends it to the thing and it beams out to the through the 5G mast, and it said like, wake up sheeple, you know. And I put some comment above it, like, which made it obvious that it was completely tongue-in-cheek what I'd put. But obviously the algorithm just picked up the image, didn't read at all. I mean, I don't think the algorithm's good at seeing satire. Hence Babylon Bee in the past. So basically it got taken down, and I got a little warning for spreading disinformation.
Twitter took down thousands of accounts that were linked to QAnon, and you wonder who gets you know, deleted, like, accidentally in that, or gets swept up in that sort of thing.
But that probably only fuels people, doesn't it?
Totally.
They go, look, it's the mainstream, like Twitter, and they're being controlled. So
it's the deep state.
Drain
the swamp.
Yeah.
And because QAnon, like, massively sees that Donald Trump is the savior in all this, that's one thing that kind of unites QAnon. It seems to be it's very pro Trump, because not necessarily that it's pro Republican or even pro right wing, but that it is anti-establishment and anti the powers that be. And Donald Trump is the mythological savior figure who comes from outside the system, and he's going to, you know, give the deep state a bloody nose. And the storm is coming. Isn't that one of the things?
Yeah, well, this is this kind of supposed day of reckoning where there's this mass arrest of journalists and politicians. I believe so. This is Donald Trump presumably being the savior, arresting these people. And they were saying, well, they'll be taken off to, you know, Guantanamo Bay, or they'll face tribunals. Even some people even saying executions. Okay. And that will usher in... the result of that will be a salvation and utopia on Earth.
Okay.
So they have this very... interestingly, there was this kind of slightly religious millennial kind of view that this will usher in this kind of thousand-year reign before Jesus comes back. Although QAnon doesn't itself seem to be Christian, there are these bits hanging around the edges where Donald Trump is this kind of figure who's going to hasten the end of days.
Right. But come on, Paul, everything's Christian, right? This is what we're learning.
That's true. We've seen that.
So that even the Christians, even the sects and the cults and the conspiracies can't help but be shaped by a kind of a Christian vision of a savior figure who upends the powers that be and brings in a new reign of peace. The trouble is, in this telling of it, is that going to be a bloody revolution? Like, how is that going to happen? Some people are worried. You know, what if November doesn't go well for QAnon? How are those people going to react to that sort of thing?
Yeah, and people are saying as well, you know, if Trump loses, that they don't think that will be the end of it.
Right.
You know, that he almost becomes... it's almost more proof.
Yeah, okay.
Like, if he stays in power, it's proof.
Yeah.
If he loses power, it's proof that they're out for him and so on. So
Right. And I did see something online for someone who's really concerned for the people who get swept up in QAnon. Just to say to somebody, look, one of the Q drops said that Hillary Clinton would be arrested between 8:45 and 9:30 a.m. on this particular date in 2017, and she wasn't. Will you now rethink the whole QAnon thing? But, you know, what we all know what happens in a cult. You know, how many times did the Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, predict the second coming of Christ? You know, they predicted it and repredicted it and repredicted it, you know. And yet when you get the person on your doorstep and you say, you know, what happened, there will be an explanation, you know.
Sure.
Perhaps there was a secret incarceration of Hillary Clinton, and, you know, in the same way that Jehovah's Witnesses think there was a secret return of Christ on various dates. And
sure,
all sorts of
things.
It becomes very hard to shake people from it. And I want to know why. Like, what do you think is attractive to people about a conspiracy theory?
I mean, I wonder whether, I mean, partly something I've been musing on from the Douglas Murray stuff is that Douglas Murray said in one of the clips we used, we've torn down so many things in our society that we may well be the first generation in the history of the world to have no real idea why we're here. And so there is this sense of, like, a bit of a meaning crisis. And for the idea that there's this kind of shadowy world hidden behind what we see, it sounds like something out of a movie, you know. you can kind of see how that could be attractive to someone to kind of give a meaning to their life. You know, this is something I can get behind, and I might play a part in overthrowing the dark powers. Or
let's bring a kind of an economic and perspective to it. You know, if your economy has taken a 20% GDP hit, as it has in the UK, and if, you know, unemployment is rife, and if you can't even leave the house, and you feel impotent in that way, feeling that you're part of something bigger that's really pulling the strings of reality, that's seductive, isn't it? But like, the smaller you think you are, you just think you're a cork on the tide of history. No, you're in touch with the deepest realities. That's very seductive, I think. And I think, you know, it's got massive overlap with Gnosticism. You go back to, even within the New Testament, I mean, Gnosticism proper kind of develops after the closing of the canon, more sort of second century than first century.
What is Gnosticism?
Gnosticism, gnosis means knowledge. Mm-hmm. So an agnostic is someone who just doesn't know. I don't know. Agnostic. But a Gnostic is one who has knowledge, but they don't have knowledge by doing the hard graft of reading the great texts and thinking deeply. It's a secret knowledge that is only available to the initiates. And there are various initiations into the secrets of reality, and it's very well, most people say that Gnosticism is dualistic, and that you've got the pneumaticoi, the spiritual ones, and you've got the psychicoi, the fleshly, like flesh, ones, the carnal ones. And most people are just rubes, right? Most people, they just got their workaday life, and they just go to the office, and they just, you know, grind along in the world. But then there are the spiritual ones. And through knowledge, through revelation of secret knowledge, they can ascend through various spiritual levels. And one of the markers of Gnosticism is real hierarchies. You know, some people are just initiated into the first level. So right, like, you know, you can probably think right now, like Masonic lodges or that kind of thing, or Scientology.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you just do the personality quiz. The guy on the street tells you, come in, do a personality quiz, it's fun. You know, that's level one, right? And then you're told it's all about Dianetics, and then that's level two. But, you know, once you get to Tom Cruise's level, it's all about Martians on, you know, the planet Zorb, and it goes really
way off, yeah,
gnarly.
Yeah.
So some people think Gnosticism is dualistic. Some people think it's monistic. But really, what it is, it's an ascent towards spiritual reality by knowing, and therefore there's a deep in Gnosticism there's a deep mistrust of the physical. There's a deep mistrust of worldly structures. You want to escape the worldly and the carnal into the spiritual and the secret knowledge. So this is why I say this crossover with conspiracy theories, because what do you have with a conspiracy theory? You say, there's the royal family, right? But you take off the mask and there are lizards underneath. They are lizard people, which is a part of the David Icke kind of conspiracy theory, isn't it? Lizard people are a big part. But it's like, you know, the world is just the myth that is pulled over your eyes.
And the Matrix.
It's the Matrix, man. What you really are is this disembodied brain in a vat kind of thing. And the real world is... the real world is not what you think it is. But if you are very clever, and if you've been inducted, and usually it's quite costly to get through the hoops, whether in conspiracy theories or cults or in Gnosticism, it's usually you pay the price to ascend the ladder of secret knowledge. And the goal really is to know. And this again, I think is massive overlap with a conspiracy theory. Wouldn't it be nice to know what's going on with COVID-19? Because we're totally at sea. You know, we don't know. Matt Hancock doesn't know. he really doesn't know. And a conspiracy theorist goes, "Yeah, see, that's just a puppet." You know, Matt Hancock is just a puppet of a greater power, and we know what's really going on with COVID.
Yeah.
What's really going on with lockdowns. We know, you know.
Yeah.
It's tempting.
Yeah.
It's attractive.
And I suppose we see levels of that, don't we, on our own social media feeds, you know, like so-and-so Dr. Fauci in the States, or is it Chris Whitty over here, you know, will say, this is what's going on with COVID, and we should do this, and we should do that, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
And then you've got, you know, on Facebook, Gary the Plasterer saying, you know, oh, but they don't know what they're talking about. Like, COVID-19 isn't what they're saying. Actually, we should all be doing this instead. And this kind of idea that there are those who, there's these experts, but we're the ones who really see behind, you know, forget all their knowledge. Like, we've got the secret knowledge. And, I mean, I was reading about the myth of the untutored genius. That was
right.
It. So whereas you've got all the people who, those suckers who spent all their time learning, well, they've been, you know, they're just drinking in the Kool-Aid of the world, you know, being blind, you know, blinded to the reality. But then there's those of us who, despite not having done any work on these things, somehow had these things revealed to us, and we know, and we're the ones
you can
that you listen to.
Yes.
Yeah, it's what my gut says, you know. So Chris Whitty says this with his years of medical training and whatever stuff on viruses.
Yes.
But, you know, with my 6 years plastering.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe.
I think I've got something on viruses,
the untutored genius.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think with my history of education, I'm just the tutored moron. The untutored genius. Yeah, yeah, I can see that. But then, you know, it is grist for the mill of a conspiracy theorist when the science, like, totally contradicts, you know. So that, you know, at the beginning of the pandemic, don't wear a mask. Don't, whatever you do, wear a mask. It's, you know, it's been shown not to work and blah, blah, blah. And then wear a mask or else, you know, you're like, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And then suddenly those authority structures break down in people's eyes. And where in previous generations you had far greater trust in the media, you had far higher trust in the church, you had far higher trust in scientists. Like, all of that is massively crumbling. So the idea that you peer behind the powers that be and see the real, what's really going on, there's all the more openness to that, I think, these days, as people trust less and less.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think we kind of, here are some things that I think conspiracy theories get right. Like, there are unseen powers in the world.
Yep.
Right. Mm-hmm. And Boris Johnson is not in charge, you know?
We can all agree on that, Glen. Like,
Matt Hancock doesn't know what he's doing. Like, there are unseen powers in the world. And the, you know, like, Christians are taught, like, from Romans 13, okay, God has put a servant in charge of you, and he's got the power of the sword, and he's the magistrate, and kind of, you know, pay your taxes. But, like, and so Christians, yeah, be a good citizen, pay your taxes, say yes sir, no sir, three bags full sir, you know, pray for the emperor, honor the emperor, pay your taxes, be a good citizen. But just know, they're not really in charge.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, yep. Because there are multiple realms of powers that are going on that are not what we see with our eyes, you know. And so there are the principalities and powers that places like Ephesians talk about. And then there is the secret cabal in charge of the world. Father, Son, and Spirit together, like, are in charge. And it is kind of, and not everybody knows the ruler and authority that is in charge of this world. Not everybody knows. Not everybody's in on that secret knowledge.
Yeah.
Kind of Christians kind of have that too. We're not as free as we think we are. And
there's a sense in which people are blinded to the truth of it.
Right.
You know, absolutely, that kind of thing, isn't there?
Right, right.
Yeah.
And so, interestingly, in the New Testament, obviously, New Testament is first century, and Gnosticism really gets going in the second century. But there are kind of these proto-Gnostic in bud kind of false teachings that are going around. And in Ephesians, it talks about things like that. In Colossians, it talks about things like that. In 2 Peter, in 1 John, Even in the early church, there are these claims about secret knowledge, and so like Colossians 2 is fascinating because Paul says, "My purpose is that you may be encouraged in heart and mind and in love, so that you may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that you may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures and of wisdom and knowledge." And if you read on in Colossians 2, you'll see that he's kind of speaking against these proto-Gnostic sects. But what he's really saying is, hey, if you really want to know about secret knowledge, if you want to know about the mystery at the heart of all things, Jesus.
Yeah.
It's right there. It's right there on full display to the whole world. So you don't need to ascend through these different initiation ceremonies or rites or rituals. You don't have to pay money. You don't have to be clever. You don't have to be powerful. Christ has come all the way down and revealed to you the mysteries of the universe.
Mm.
Like, this is what God's like. And most people look at that and go, nah, can't be. But those who do, their eyes have been opened. So there is kind of a crossover.
Yeah, sure.
I do think that Christians can be more susceptible to conspiracy theories than most.
Mm. And didn't you have a little video about this? I think with a couple of guys you chatted about this.
Yes, that's
right. During the lockdown period.
Yeah, I think Christians can be more susceptible to conspiracy theories because we think there's a secret cabal in charge of the world, right? Because I think that we're not as free as we think we are. That the rulers are to be obeyed, but they're not really what's pulling the strings in this world. So I think we're more susceptible to conspiracy theories. But I also think we've been more skeptical of bad governments down through history than most. Because we've been told a story where the ultimate power comes down and divests himself of power and tells the truth and upends everything. And it turns out that even though the world crucified him, he was right and the powers that be were wrong.
Mm.
Like, we inhabit that story. And so so we're more likely to believe that Gary the Plasterer, because we believe in Jesus the Carpenter.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and it wasn't Cicero that saved the world.
Mm.
And it wasn't Socrates that saved the world. It was a carpenter. So I think Christians are more likely to believe Gary the Plasterer.
Yeah.
As long as Gary the Plasterer has truth on his side. And that's where I think, you know, we need to be, in a sense, more and more skeptical. And what I think we can say to the world is everybody believes weird stuff and everybody is gullible about stuff. A few years ago, Darren Brown tweeted out, we'll put it up on the screen. It was brilliant. It's the one time Darren Brown interacted with me on Twitter and I corrected him. I was right and he was wrong. So basically Darren Brown tweeted out on December the 23rd, 2013, he retweeted something saying, oh, in Vatican III, the Pope declares that all religions are true. That's very interesting. And he just sort of tweeted it out there. And I just commented and said, that's a hoax, by the way. There's no such thing as Vatican III. Be more skeptical. Winky face. And then Darren Brown actually, what does he say? He says, ah, dear me. Pope's supposed liberal statements were a hoax. Thanks, Glen Scrivener. And it's fascinating to me because, like, who has made his career out of being skeptical?
Mr. Skeptical right there.
Yeah. Showing you how, like, other people can be fooled.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just... And so he wanted to believe that the Pope was heading in a certain direction and might say a certain thing.
Yeah,
and so just
sure.
Unthinkingly retweeted something. That's something any of us could do. But just interesting that he could fall for something that is untrue like that. Or my other example that I love is when Stephen Fry just went off on QI. About how Christmas is really just a repackaging of Mithras. Did you catch it first time around on
QI?
Yeah, it's done the rounds. Let's have a look.
So, let's just take a few moments then together and try to remember, why is Christmas Day on December the 25th?
Ring, ring, ring-a-ding.
Oh. It's the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yo!
Wallamy, wallamy, woo. Well, that's all we get it out of the way.
Yes.
Is that a very, very small fire or are those huge stars?
It's a midwinter solstice. It's a pagan festival that's been appropriated by Christianity.
There is a great deal of truth in that.
Do I get the points back?
You will certainly get some back. It was indeed, there's a Teutonic, Celtic and pagan view that if you've survived the winter solstice on the 21st of December, you have a feast to celebrate. But also, there was the Roman god.
Was it Saturnalia?
Was the Saturnalia, was also at that time of year, but there was Mithras.
Just the two of them were there?
Well, there are amazing things claimed about Mithras, and I'll read you some of them. He was a saviour, Mithras, sent to Earth to live as a mortal, through whom it was possible for sinners to be reborn into immortal life. He died for our sins, but came back to life the following Sunday. He was born of a virgin on December the 25th in a manger, or perhaps a cave, attended by shepherds, and became known as the Light of the World. He had 12 disciples with whom he shared a last meal before dying. His devotees symbolically consumed the flesh and blood of him. Because Mithras was a sun god, he was worshipped on Sundays.
Is he a tribute band?
He's often depicted with a halo around his head. Oh. And Mithraists gave each other gifts on December the 25th. The leader of the religion was called a papa, and their HQ was on Vatican Hill in Rome.
And you're kind of writing off the chance that this was just a massive coincidence. And then one day they all went to the Vatican and went, what? Ah, hang on.
Well, a lot of Christian scholars have since been very angry at some of this research, which came out in 1903 about Mithraists, and they claim it's nonsense.
And what can be said to that except to play Lutheran satires, Horace Ruins Christmas, where he takes Stephen Fry's thesis to the woodshed. Let's have a look.
Behold, it is I, Mithras, Roman cultic god of the something-something, and why you all believe that you've been celebrating the birth of Jesus, you've really been celebrating the birth of me. For you see, I, Mithras, was born of a virgin. I, Mithras, had 12 disciples, and I, Mithras, gave those disciples a meal consisting of my body and my blood. Sound familiar, Christian dummies?
Actually, Mithras was born from a rock, not of a virgin. He had 2 companions, not 12 disciples, and the Mithraic meal was one he shared with the sun god, where they feasted not on his own flesh, but on the flesh of a bull. But even if those claims were true, Christians were already confessing the virgin birth, recognizing the 12 apostles, and celebrating the Lord's Supper before they ever encountered any Mithraic cults. So I'm afraid that you've taken neither the holly nor the jolly out of our Christmas, Mithras.
Oh, you must have misheard me. I'm not Mithras. I'm,
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, the wonderful thing about that, there's the brilliant irony, of course, is that QI sets out, doesn't it, to show you there are all these things that you traditionally believe, which are just actually completely false.
Yes.
And then Stephen Fry does the very thing that the show is aiming to do. So,
I mean, if you could name I don't think you can name 2 more skeptical people in the public eye. You know, people
sure.
are famous for debunking stuff.
Very much so.
And you're just like, yeah, okay, well, so we can all buy into myths that we want to be true.
Mm.
We can all do that. What's the answer to that? And I just think Matthew 10 is amazing on these things. Matthew 11, Matthew 11. Jesus has done a preaching tour and people are not responding. And you would think that Jesus would say, "Oh gosh, I'm threatened by people's unbelief in me." He's not threatened by that at all. Instead, at that time, verse 25, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this was your good pleasure." So there are those who think they are so clever who they've figured out the kingdom. They've figured out how God's operating in the world. What is the true operating system of the world? I'm wise. I'm learned. I've figured it out. And Jesus is like, no, God hides things from the wise and learned and reveals them to little children. That's his good pleasure. And then he says, all things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. So there is the cabal. the secretive cabal in charge of the world. And, you know, if you had to end the verse halfway through verse 27, we'd be in great trouble. You know, no one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son. Okay, so no one knows anything except God. But then, those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him, there is a way of knowledge. And he has revealed himself to little children so that you don't come to him having jumped through the hoops. You don't come to him having ascended the ladder or paid any price or sacrificed or done any rituals or initiation ceremonies. You just come as little children and it is revealed to you, and you come as a little child. And then verse 28, he's just so universal. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And you might think that coming to QAnon or coming to some kind of conspiracy theory that gives you a handle on the world will give you rest. Doesn't seem to be. Like, I've seen a few of the YouTubers who are QAnon. They don't seem to be at rest, you know.
Right, yeah.
They seem to be very agitated, very exercised. You know, in a sense, you know, the thousand-year reign is down to them. You know, can we figure out the Q drops, and can we... And how different to come to Jesus and have rest, because I'm just a little child, and the Son of the Father is going to sort it all out for me. And then he says, take my yoke on you and learn from me. That is a free education, free at the point of access, you know, universal, comprehensive education that Jesus gives to people. You don't have to pay money for it. You don't have to jump through hoops. But you do have to walk the way of Christ. And I think this is the secret that unlocks the world. Apparently, the world belongs to Jesus. It belongs to the crucified one. And therefore, it belongs to the ones who walk in his ways, so that the meek inherit the earth. Who's in charge of the earth? Well, there's a father-son cabal. But by the Spirit, that's opened up to you. And now, it's meekness. It's Christ-likeness. It's sacrifice. It's love even of your enemy. Love even of the rubes who don't get it. So that I don't feel proud because I'm on the inside of this secret. The secret is that I should live my life for the world, turned out towards them in sacrifice and self-giving. So I think that's kind of... in some ways, it sounds like a conspiracy theory, you know?
Sure, yeah. And we see in the Gospels that there is that element, isn't there, of a conspiracy theory put up forth, isn't it? Well, let's just say that when the body is gone,
right,
we'll pay the soldiers and we'll tell them to say the disciples came and they did all this stuff. So
yeah,
you can see how people in some sense wanted there to be this, you know, if this isn't true, it's a conspiracy and
there's
stuff behind it as well. So
yeah, that is interesting. So what's the alternative to Jesus rising from the dead? I guess it's a conspiracy of the disciples to pull off the greatest hoax ever. But then, you know, what do Christians want to do with that claim? That it was just a conspiracy theory. Do we go, oh, I guess we just we happen to trust the conspirators. You happen not to. We don't do that, do we? We investigate the conspiracy theory and we figure out, well, no. Let's think about what it would involve for this conspiracy theory to be true. You know, would Peter and Paul and all the rest of the disciples give up their careers and lives and safety?
Yeah. Go to their deaths and
to proclaim a lie that they knew was a lie.
That didn't really benefit them in their life.
No.
You know?
No. And in so doing, pen the greatest work of moral philosophy of the ages, while founding everything on a lie. And then somehow having their movement work. Like, somehow it worked. Like, fishermen, idiots, you know, like the, you know, when I don't say fishermen are idiots, I say Peter was an idiot who happened to be a fisherman. And somehow it came off.
Yeah.
You know, and so Christians don't say, believe the conspiracy theory. They say press into it. Do you think there's a conspiracy theory of the disciples that have pulled off Christianity? Well, look into it. Look into the evidence. And Christians aren't afraid of the evidence and researching into it. But If you happen to not believe in that conspiracy theory, therefore, what are you left with? Okay, Jesus rose from the dead.
Mm.
And there's this much better conspiracy over here, in which the Son is conspiring with the Father by the Spirit to love the world and to invite the world, you know, to himself, so that there won't be that distinction between the outsider and the insider, but that you're freely offered a place at the table, same as everybody else. So I think that's the kind of stuff I would say to people who are involved in conspiracy theories. Like, in one sense, you're more right than you know. Like, there is more going on in this world than we ever give credit for. But it's more wonderful. It's not there are reptiles in charge of the world, you know? Yeah. It's that there's a Father governing all things in the Son by the Spirit. Good news. Come on home to it. That'll do about the secret cabal ruling the world.
Yeah.
Brilliant. If people want to catch up with us more, Paul, where can they find us?
Yeah, well, you can head over to the website, speaklife.org.uk, where you can find out all about us. But if you want to kind of keep up to the minute with stuff, then obviously find us on Facebook, Speak Life UK on there, and on our Twitter feed, Speak Life, there as well. Find us on Instagram as well. So we're still Speak Life UK everywhere, basically. It's the place to find us. So any social media feeds or the website, that's the place to go.
That's the place to go. And stay tuned for Douglas Murray coming out. We've got a clips video where we've got the 10 greatest things that he said on the subject of religion. Mm. And we've got my hour-long interview with him, which was fascinating. I learned loads. I hope you will too. Thanks so much for joining us, and we'll catch you again next time. God bless.
Fizzle out.